أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله النبي الحبيب الكريم. Welcome to International Sufi Center. Today is 23rd of November 2018, and we have a guest who belongs to a great Sufi lineage, Mr. Sayyid Ahmed Mustafa, a software engineer and an ardent student of Sufism. He has come here to learn about the great tradition of the Awliya Ikrams, who have all arisen from the teachings of our Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mr. Sayyid Ahmed Sahib, I request you to pose questions so that it can be a good question answer series, then to give a monologue from my side. The question answer series will be better for the reader, for the listeners, who can be able to grasp certain aspects, and their concentration will be better. So, Mr. Sayyid Ahmed Sahib, please proceed to ask some questions and which you would like to know from us.
Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. So, my first question to for you would be, like, even though after doing wazifas and even though after praying namaz and even though with being with people who are into the path of Sufism, but still the inner self or the desires do go away when you are with these kind of people. But again, when you leave the company of these people or go to other different places, you could literally see that the desires and the inner self shooting up, or just like a weed coming out of the sand. But it is again difficult to handle the emotions at that point of time. So how do you see this?
This is not a new question. This question has been being asked to every saint and every prophet, because when our prophet was Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also asked the same question by a Sahabi. A Sahabi came to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, so long as I am sitting with you, my faith, that is Iman, is very strong. I feel like sacrificing myself and my parents. But when I leave you, the faith also leaves me. This is a common phenomena. The reason perhaps is that we have lot of priorities in our mind. Most important priority is to find employment, to gain full employment, and to carry on all the functions which are required to carry out our jobs for our useful living. And along with the living, we have so many things which are required for us to fulfill. Our family obligations, our friends, our relatives. So Sufism should not be disconnected with these aspects of life. Sufism, there is nothing like ism. Ism is a study, like communism, socialism. The main aspect is the aspect of purification of soul. What is it that is impure that is required to be purified? Is the first question. Or is there any impurity? We can't say we have impurity, but we have inclinations and proclivity, that is tendency, to be attracted to certain basic fundamental features or negative traits of man, which has been categorized into 7 of them, and these 7 can multiply into many more. Into 7 into 7, 49. And generally it is frustrations. We get frustrations for a very small thing, and that generates some sort of emotional crisis, and you can say it is anger, you may say it is jealousy or some feeling of want or your own selfishness. Selfishness is you want to protect yourself and you don't want to sacrifice yourself for somebody else. You want everything to be done to you without your participation, and you want things to happen in the way you want and not in the way the features are required to be done. Where a common household or a community requires a certain degree of discipline, you want to just escape and you would like to have a lot of rest mentally and physically. And that is, it develops into a higher degree, and that is known as sloth and slumber. So we have this anger and jealousy, sloth and slumber, and we have this greed to have more and more and more, and you are not satisfied at all. This is dissatisfaction. Then you have a craze for your passions to be fulfilled, and you want your passions which arise from your five senses, you want that to be fulfilled. And you have many more such things, and you always cast your eyes on others' properties, and you don't feel that the other one should deserves it and it is his hard work. But somehow some aspects of your inner psyche works to do harm to somebody else, and without consciously or unconsciously you carry on these activities. So the process of cleansing is to stay away from these aspects which are proclivities in the inner soul. And the soul is required to be directed to better way of thinking, and that can come only when you start slowly shedding your selfishness, your self-centeredness, and your I-ness, I am everything, that is known as ego. You have to proceed towards graciousness, magnanimity, and higher aspects of human soul, which is very difficult to acquire. Because in the first instant you would feel, what I earn is not sufficient for me, I have got my own wants, I don't have, now the winter has set in, I don't have warm clothes, I don't have anything I can give to others. Sure, sure, that is a common cry of the humanity, and we don't have and we need to have more and more, and for our satisfaction, for our needs, for our family needs, for our children's need, all these things are common. But what is it which is required to be given up and acquired? When you give up, there is a vacuum in your mind and heart. You have to acquire something, and that should be goodness. The whole thing is to do a thing in a right way. And that is what is the main thing which has been realized after years of meditation by Siddhartha, who became Gautama. He became Buddha, enlightened soul. And he said, oh, this is nothing, it is your own self, your own desires. And you more and more you want your desires to be fulfilled, the feeling of acquisition, holding property or something, it may be a small little thing, a child may be yearning to have a more and more toys. So, or you would like to have better food, you would like to have too many other servings. And you may not be satisfied with a simple anna sambar. You would like to have a lot of vegetables, you have non-vegetarian food, you want to have dessert, you want to have a lot of drinks, you want to have your taste fulfilled. So whatever Prophet, Holy Prophet have said is, if you guarantee me of two things, I will guarantee you heaven. And it is, first thing he asked was, you have to control your tongue and your sexual organ and take care of your stomach. What is it that is performed by the tongue? You learn language and you speak language. And through language you can hurt others or you can do good things. You can speak softly, you can speak gently, you can use right words, appropriate words. But that requires a lot of self-control. And the tongue performs the function of taste. It's most important because you have to know the taste to take the food. You may take a poison, that you know, the tongue recognizes. This is something which should not be eaten for the body. But most important aspect which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to is that the tongue, when it gives promises, it should fulfill, because truth is ultimate. Truth is glamorous. Truth always sustains itself. It is everlasting. While a lie cannot last. Lie is like a wave on the seashore. It comes and goes. It comes and goes. It is not permanent. But the truth is permanent. Like the sun, the truth is like a sun. It is glorious. It is full of light. It is full of eminence. It is full of glory. So that you have to become truthful so that you are glorified. You use the tongue to glorify the name of the Lord. You have to glorify the name of the Lord with your tongue. If you are using the tongue for abusive language, for hurting others, then the results and consequences are very bad. So the Prophet, when he mentioned that you have to control your tongue, he meant to draw your attention to truth. God is truth. God is love. God is knowledge. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also truthful. He is also trustworthy. He never broke his promise. And you would notice the government of any country has a central bank, and the governor of the central bank signs on your currency note. He says, I promise to pay the bearer a sum of rupees 100, 200, 500, 1000, the value of it. Wherever you go and produce that currency note, and the value of whatever of the same is reimbursed in the form of any commodity or anything, or value of service which others perform. So it has a value which is signed. It is a promise. And that promise cannot be broken. So just as the governor of a reserve bank has promises to pay to the bearer the sum of rupees so and so, you are also required to maintain your word of honor. If a person is not honorable, he always breaks his promise. So the tongue has to perform its duty of honoring its words. That's the most important. And people who are cheats, who never, they are compulsive liars, they never fulfill the word. They never fulfill the promise. So the promise has to be fulfilled. And so also with the stomach. Because you have a good taste for food, you cannot overload your stomach. It is very detrimental to your health. Likewise, you have to take care of your sexual organ. You cannot be freely sowing the oats wildly. You have to enter into a promise of marriage and maintain that word of honesty and integrity, and not break the word of sanctity attached to the marriage. And you have to be loyal to your wife and not cheat her. So these three things are basic for the maintenance of a stable society, for a good family and a good neighborhood, and a good community, and a good state. So it has to be very constant. So faith is nothing but maintaining your word, to pursue truth, to work for truth, and to enjoy the truth which is available in the nature. Nature is truthful. And if you see the Holy Quran, you would notice that God is taking oath on material things like sun, stars, moon. Where does God take the oath? The oath was always considered as sacred in societies, in a society. So people are asked to take an oath of honor. And if a person breaks the oath, he was dishonored. So the Prophet, instead of he taking the oath of speaking the truth, he says, no, God will take the truth on my behalf. So the God speaks the truth and takes the oath that whatever our Prophet is uttering is truth, and you have to follow it for your own benefit and benefit of the mankind. So when you ask me this question as to why we get disturbed and why there is so much of distraction in the mind, it is because our faith is very weak. We must have very strong conviction, and we should have very courage of conviction. We should not break our basic promise to live a truthful living. If you utter truth, practice truth, walk on the path of the truth, you will reach the beauty, you will acquire love in your mind and heart, and your heart becomes very gracious. Your heart glorifies itself, and you are a man of honor, you are a man of truth, and you have a very kind, affectionate, loving self in your own self, and you would never commit a wrong, you would never commit a hurt to others, and from you the family gets benefited and the whole society gets benefited. If truth has to be practiced, you have to control your emotions, control your mental turmoils and all that is going, and not get disappointed. Lot of trials and tribulations takes place in your life. You have to get prepared for it like a soldier who gets prepared to face the war. Life is like a war. You have to train yourself fully, and that is why the basic training given by the parents at the time of your upbringing should never be forgotten. You will get bad friends. If you sow a bad seed, you will have a bad plant and it will give a bad fruit. If you want sweet fruits, you have to work very hard to cultivate the earth with good fertilizers, and you have to tend the plant and see it grows itself into a good plant and gives good flowers, good fruits. So if you want to enjoy good fruits, you have to work very hard. There is no two opinion about it. You cannot expect things to happen to you without working, and you want to rob another person of his hard work. So you have to control these inclinations, these tendencies, these proclivities to cheat others, and you are not cheating your own self and putting your mind and heart and soul to do good for yourself and for the others, then the life becomes very beautiful. That is what is beauty. So I request you to pose more questions.
Yeah, thanks for the very great explanation. So my next question is very much relevant to Sufism. Sufism is truth and has been practiced from even before our last prophet. However, at recent times, people do ask a very sensible question from a layman's perspective. That is, when we have Quran, when we have Hadith, so why does any person needs a master or a peer to train him? Because of which most of the laymen who do not have any knowledge about Sufism or even about the basic concepts of life, they do get taken away with these questions. And also I would like to say that since your grandfather Sayyid Shahabuddin alayhi salam had written a book on the same, so I believe you have the right capacity to talk about it and explain us about it.
See, your first teacher is your mother. Have you learned your mother tongue on your own? If you had been brought up among the animals, you would have been only chattering like monkeys. So you have to be given right word, right language, right conduct, right behavior, right thinking, right action. All this you have learned from your parents and teachers. So likewise, when you want to walk on the path of truth and see and get yourself enlightened and want to see the effulgence of the Lord, it cannot come on its own, because as I said just now, that the life throws up lot of challenges and you get confused. You are not comfortable at all. At every step you have difficulties. Quran Sharif and Hadith, it speaks about hundreds and thousand things. How do you put it in the right time and right place? Can you learn on your own and understand on the way in which has to be understood? You cannot misapply a law. You cannot misinterpret law. Law has to be properly applied and properly interpreted and to the situation in which you are. Only a teacher can do it who is experienced, who has learned from his master has from his master, and the chain goes to up to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam through all great saints. So the sainthood and becoming a sage is not so simple. They have to walk on the straight path on which the God's blessings have been coming there. اہدنا الصراط المستقیم صراط الذین انعمت علیہم غیر المغضوب علیہم ولا الضالین. Show me the path on which the grace of Lord has been showering. It is only in respect of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Almighty God has spoken that I have been showering my grace even before his birth, from the time when the cosmos has come into existence, and it will continue to shower his salams and grace till the end of the world. So he is, God is directing that you should follow the Prophet. So no, the humanity was directed to follow him. You cannot follow on your own without following Prophet. And so I can learn myself, this is a democratic living, this is a communist living, this is a socialistic living. Why do we need any prophets and saints and sages? Because they are full of wisdom, they are full of compassion, they are full of mercy. Their teachings keep the society into a particular hold. So just as you have the knowledge of the external world into so many subjects, from astronomy to mathematics to physics, chemistry, geology, natural sciences, and meteorological sciences, thousands of sciences are there which you learn from your masters. Likewise, there is the science of inner self. Inner self includes the medicine, it includes biochemistry, but also pertains to analytical psychology, psychiatry, and there is the science of your own soul which guides your body. So, Sufism is also a science. It speaks about the higher stages of human soul, higher consciousness. There are different levels of consciousness, like the animal consciousness, moral consciousness, divine consciousness. When you reach the divine consciousness, the effulgence or the light of the Noor, he imitates in you from a mind and heart. You become a true human being, a evolved human being, a divine human being. For that you need a master who only guides you. He doesn't take any money at all. He guides you how you have to do the meditation, how you have to interpret the various signs of the nature, how you have to interpret your own dreams, how you have to control your inner self, how you have to meditate, how you have to practice various things to achieve the inner goal. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the saints have laid down certain method to achieve this goal, to achieve and reach this goal. To reach this goal of attaining supreme bliss, solace and greatness in your human mind and soul, you have to have a teacher. If not, you become a ruffian. And it is possible that an unguided, unbridled horse can become a scoundrel. Nobody can ride a horse which is a wild one. The horse have to be trained. It has to be properly trained, and only a trainer can teach you how to ride a horse. You cannot just buy a most costliest car like a Benz or a similar cars, and without having a license or without having the knowledge of driving, and knowledge of the car, you cannot just think of running an automobile on the road. There are certain rules and regulations, and you have to learn how to operate a car. So also with regard to the airspace or helicopters or planes, a soldier has to be trained. Untrained soldier cannot be taken to the battlefield. He has to know the topography, he has to know how to judge the enemy, he should know how to use the weapons, he should know how to safeguard himself, camouflage himself, how he has to attack. All those things has to be taught to him by the generals and the colonels and the brigadiers and his subedar majors and his teachers. He has to be able-bodied. Only able-bodied can have. So the body has to be understood, the soul has to be understood, the mind has to be understood. To understand all this, a regular teacher is required, and a teacher is referred by various names in different cultures. A peer means in the Persian language a teacher, while a same thing in Arabic it is known as murshid. So in Sanskrit he is referred to as guru. So this guru chela system is required to make you a perfect human being, a gentleman. Nobody can become gentle on their own. It requires training. An enormous training is required to pass through various stages of Sufism.
Yeah, thank you for this great answer, Piran Sahib. And my next question is about Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, wherein today again most of the Sufis do take solitude and without any knowledge of this, as I say again, that the layman, they say that, you know, kind of this is not so permissible within the they kind of say that they have to come out and live with everybody and anybody. However, whether this is my question is that with this background, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had, even before his first wahi would come, after his marriage, he would leave the God of house, which is Kaabatullah, and go and stay in solitude for 40 days, after which, in a mount, after which the first wahi had come. So we are not talking about unknown of a layman. We are talking about the Prophet who leaded the namaz for all the prophets, all the messengers before him. So he is leaving the God of house, that is Kaabatullah, and he goes and stays in solitude where the wahi comes. What is your opinion on this, about solitude and ibadat?
The whole aspect of human living is to achieve peace, tranquility, solace. How will you achieve it? If you get involved too much into the aspects of living, which is not required. For instance, people gamble and they have nightclubs. They go for racing, they go for playing cards, game of chance. They get involved so much in these entertainments that ultimately there is a loss of peace. They are unable to come back to the normal way of life. People who take to drugs, take to alcoholism, take to extramarital sex, take to homosexuality and lesbianism. If you go into the belly of the society, you would find lot of things happening. There are thousands of court cases against truants, those who have erred in their life. They have become compulsive liars, they become criminals, they are murderers. So if you go into the psychology of all these aspects and find out why does the mind work like this, you would have read in the newspapers about billions of rupees having been cheated to the banks. And so many banks had to be closed, banks had to be merged. And you know there is environment devastation which is taking place, the ecological destruction which is taking place, the massive wars which have been going on in the world. What is it that prompts a man to do all these things? Why does a man does not live peacefully when animals and birds and nature lives peacefully? So it is the evil nature of man. So each individual is blessed with goodness and evil. But the evil takes a greater part on your mind and heart. So you have to nurture your goodness. You have to captivate your evil tendencies and evil traits. It is only through self-analysis. It is through self-introspection. It is going into your own inner self to know what you are, what you have acquired through your genes from your forefathers. Maybe your forefathers were saints, but it is not so in all the cases. In so many hundreds of cases, their fathers or parents or forefathers must have been cheats, frauds, who have been criminals, people who have done lot of harm to humanity, and they have acquired those genetical traits. How will you curb it? How will you change your inner identity? You have to change your inner identity and see that your inner self has become a glorious one. For that you need meditation. You need to sit in silence and come back to the inner good self of yours. You have a devilish nature. There is nothing separate devil outside in the your consciousness. You cannot see the devil, you cannot see those angels. Where are those devils? Where are those angels? It is the angels and devils are there in your mind. Your mind becomes devilish, your mind becomes angelic. So first you should know what your inner self is, what your inner self comprises of, what are your inner desires, inner frustrations, inner tendencies, inner inclinations. When you go into all these aspects with the help of your teacher, you would know your own self. When you have discovered your own self, then you practice the truth and love, graciousness, and so many aspects pertaining to goodness. There are many, many, many. If there are 100 evil traits, there are 100 good traits. So you have to carry on an inner war. You have to become your own policeman. And you have to curb your evil tendencies. For that you have to sit in meditation, practice yoga, practice Sufi thought, and put curbs in your mind and heart pertaining to evil, and develop goodness so that the goodness spreads. And if there are hundreds of such people in a society, they will all become very great scientists, great sociologists, and so great ideals will come to them. They will become very great productive. And whatever science you have acquired, you become a good citizen and you carry on your duties very peacefully. So the people who say we don't need to do meditation, perhaps they are captivated by evil because they have taken up to smoking, they have taken up to drugs, they would have taken up to a lot of nightlife and extramarital sex. And they don't have, I have seen thousands of cases. I have decided 30 to 60,000 cases as a judge in the court. I know the type of evil. We are taken through all the criminal courts, civil courts. I was a lawyer myself for about 16 years. And I know the cruelty. As a lawyer, we were asked as a consultant, labor consultant, the management, factory management would ask us to build up cases against poor workers. They are in shattered conditions. Because without inquiry, without charges being proved, no man can be removed from the job. So they used to ask us to build up false cases because all wickedness. Man has got a wicked nature, a cruel nature. And a wicked and cruel nature has come down from millions of years because we were animals. And we have to hunt for our own food. We have to kill animals to eat ourselves. We have to protect ourselves by killing another animal. This tendency of wickedness, cruelty is inbuilt. So you would notice that so much of cruelty is practiced, so much of crime, so much of falsehood is there, and head of the family dies, those who are controlling his wealth, they would create a lot of false documents and deprive all others of the wealth. And there are cases and cases galore. You know, a person like Vijay Mallya having cheated 10,000 crores or more. Likewise, there are hundreds of such big businessmen who have looted the banks. And they not only through showing they are a good businessman, but even through evil methods. But there are so many dacoits who go break open the houses and loot the wealth. Now, if they want to change and they want to become a good person like Buddha, can you just tell them, okay, you wear a yellow robe and wear a green turban, you will become, and take a rosary in your hand, you have become a great man. Can it happen? It is not through your external thing, but your inner change has to come. To bring an inner change, you have to sit down and curb your evil tendencies, which have a great hold on your psyche. Your psyche has to be changed. So those persons who say we don't need all these things, they are all cheats. They are liars. They are frauds. They don't know. They tell lies like anything for their livelihood, for their glory, for their name, for their fame. They do a lot of evil things. I know. I have been with them. We have the Sufi Center last 15 years. And I have been a student of great saints for the last 50 years. I am now reaching 70. At the age of 13, I was initiated in Sufism. And I was brought up in a very religious way, in a spiritual way from my childhood. But I was exposed to all this evil. I have gone and sat I have done my postgraduate in social service administration. I have done law. I have done a lot of social research on various evils of society. We have gone into all this in depth. as to how evil in society crops up. Ultimately, we come down to the same old question, it is the human self. It is the human self which is directing all these things. Both the devil and the angel is in their mind. It is this mind which creates the atom bomb, it is the mind which creates the electricity. It is the mind which creates the benefits of the electricity and the mind which can be, which creates the destruction through electricity. So if you want to see the glory of the Lord and the Prophet and the saint and you want to become a saint and a sage, you have to adopt the path of truth. For that, the fundamental requirement for a truth, to achieve truth, is deep meditation, penance. Why do you have to penance? It's only to curb your evil tendencies which have been passed on to you from generations and generations. It is there in your genes. It requires a lot of efforts to change it. That is why you have to remain away from the society after your job is done. And it's not difficult. Your boss will be asking you to do a lot of evil things for him. He wants to make profits, huge profits. Every day you read it in your newspapers, there is nothing but evil. About all the crimes, about all the evil things taking place, so much of disruption in political life, so much of dishonesty in the police. What is honesty? What is integrity? What is truth? How to remain that? Is it so easy to practice? No, it requires lot of efforts, lot of inner persuasions you have to make and hold on to the truth. It's not so. It's a very slippery world. It's like playing a game of snake and ladder. You need the right number to avoid the snake on the path. And when you may reach the number 98, and 99 there is a huge snake. And on the home you have to have. So you have the dice in your hand and you want number 2, not number 1, because there is a snake and it will bring you down the beginning. And you can't start a new living then. So you pray, and you put the dice asking the Lord to give you that number. Destiny, asking destiny. If you don't believe in God, you'll say destiny. Oh, give me two. You are shaking the dice in your hand. When you put it, you may get number 1. So how does this number 1 play in your mind? It's all your karmas. All your evils or bad things you have done in your life. You have been a good man. You have done wrong. Curb your indulgences. There is some inner force, magnetic force, which helps you to avoid this dirty evil which is there on the number 99, and you pass and you go to the home, that may be heaven. To reach heaven, that is the bliss, supreme bliss, solace and tranquility and joy, and that is heaven. And when you want to avoid this fire of inner belly and the sexual fire and the desires and the all evil tendencies, I know what evil is. It has curbed my mind also. It has affected my mind also by being working with all of them. I was a judge for 20 years. I had to give up the judicial position by taking voluntary. And 4.5 years, I could not bear anymore. It is impossible. Because the forces work with great devastating and destructive force. You need to have very great strength and you should have a lot of people to support you. And not when the criminals have joined the forces, they occupy high position and they write against you, they build up cases against you. I had to go to the court to establish truth. I called it a day because I was happy. I was in home and children had to be given higher education. I needed benefits of my pension. So these things, if you have to follow the truth, you need to have truth people who will help you chart things in your life. They will draw a chart. They will help you in each step. You take this step. Like the masters who play the chess game. What move I should make? Second move, third move. If I take this move, the opponent may act like this. The forces may act, evil forces may act like this. So it is a day-to-day experience. Life is an experience of evil and good. So the more you do practice, the more you do meditation, the more you do silence, the inner force, the inner consciousness, the inner light will guide you. That is what is guidance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the answer. Thank you.